Today on More Than Home, we have one of Dallas-Fort Worth's top plastic surgeons. But before we jump into today's show, we're getting a lot of clients reaching out to us asking, hey, what's my house worth? Because they're just seeing what the market is doing and it's exploding right now. So shoot us an email, hi@threevinegroup.com, and we'll get you that valuation.
Welcome to More Than Home. Today we've got Dr. Sean Hill with Lone Star Plastic Surgery up in Frisco. He is a double board certified plastic surgeon, Living Magazine's Best of 2020, and also D Magazine Top Doctor. So thank you for coming on the show today. We're very excited to have you.
Well, thanks for having me, Lindsay and Timothy Oliphant over here in the corner, also known as Hans. I'm happy to be here because for once, it was a close competition, but I'm still the most handsome person in the room.
Right. No, it was close. We appreciate that.
Yeah. There's a lot of beauty. There's so much attractiveness at this desk right now. It is palpable. Your audience can actually palpate how handsome and attractive the audience is today.
You guys can feel that, right? So
don't be intimidated, everyone. This is all natural. Yeah. So
is it because, speaking of handsome, that's kind of what you do for a living, is make people more beautiful.
I do wake up like this most mornings, but I am not only a provider of Botox, I'm also a client. So there
Botox.
You go.
Yes.
Yeah, there you go. So I do dabble in the evil arts, if you will.
I like it. I like it very much. How did you get started in the evil arts, if you will?
Plastic surgery, when I initially went to med school, I thought I was going to be doing family medicine because I really wanted to build these long-term relationships with patients. But then after about a month in the anatomy lab, I realized anatomy was the coolest thing in the world and that I have a background in the arts, I have a background in the sciences, and so plastic surgery seemed to be the perfect meld of the two. And so I kind of found my way into plastic surgery, and as you can imagine, a lot of my patients are longtime patients that come in for this or that or the other, so it does still hold that.
So kind of got best of both worlds there.
Best of both worlds, yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool. And you're located in Frisco. What made you choose Frisco, Texas?
Real estate, just kidding. well, kind of, not really. But no, I mean, I trained at UT Southwestern in Dallas. I love DFW. It's a great place to practice plastic surgery. It's a vibrant community. Mm-hmm. And I didn't necessarily want to live in Dallas proper because I grew up in a small town. So I'm kind of a small town boy at heart. Aww. And so Frisco kind of has that perfect meld of being a city on the rise, but also having a little bit of a small town feel to it, and so thus Frisco was the perfect place for me. So.
Yeah. Did it have anything to do with like clients or kind of like what you specialize in or anything like that? What do you specialize in?
Being awesome.
Yeah,
yes,
obviously.
I'm about 100% awesome.
Uh-huh. And then first place.
Yep,
first place.
Piss excellence. I actually kind of thought I'd come out be doing, because you know, in plastic surgery you can do reconstructive stuff like, you know, wounds, breast cancer, skin cancer and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then kind of 50-50 with cosmetics, but you know, Frisco, Texas is a very vibrant community with a lot of disposable income, if you will. So cosmetic surgery is really kind of where I do more than anything at this point in time.
Yeah.
So it's probably 80-20 with 20% being the cancer type things and 80% being cosmetics.
Yeah.
And so kind of in that realm, you know, Frisco is a lot of, if your viewers are not, don't know Frisco, it's, you know, a lot of 35 to 55 year old young families. And so it's a lot of kind of the mommy makeovers, if you will.
Yeah.
So I do probably that most of all, specifically breast. I do a ton of breast stuff in my practice.
Mm-hmm.
And then probably number two would be noses. So, you know, people that can't breathe well, we do like the septal deviation thing. We also do cosmetic nose.
Yeah.
And then probably number three is like non-surgical, which is kind of a growing thing right now here in kind of, I guess, in the past.
Non-surgical, like Botox.
Well, non-surgical falls into anything. I mean, like Botox, Brotox.
Yeah.
You know, fillers.
What was that wink there?
That was a wink. You know,
don't have it.
Yeah,
no,
I need some. Yeah. Who does some? Can someone out there help me?
Yeah.
But like also like, you know, non-surgical things like, you know, there's like, we have a skin tightening devices in the office. So I have a lot of people that are, you know, come in, you know, because, you know, I think I was mentioning to you guys off the air that, you know, what we see or seeing a lot of right now is kind of what we call the Zoom boom, if you will. So, you know, a lot of people are on Zoom. Like right now, for example, like I'm talking to you guys, but there's a video over here of my face, right?
Yeah.
And you can't help but look at your own face. Right. When I'm on Zoom, I spend most of the time trying not to look at my own face.
Yeah.
And so people are noticing things about themselves that they had no idea they were there. I've had patients that have been coming to me for Botox for years, right? And we've been doing forehead and the 11s, right? That's what we've been doing for 2 years. And suddenly, all of a sudden, I see all these people are like, oh my God, I didn't realize that I have these lines over here when I smile. Right. And they're like, oh my God, it's terrible. Can we please take care of that?
Yeah.
Or I have patients that are like, I didn't realize I had this right here. Is there something that we can do about this? So things that were not an issue and like long-term patients suddenly are coming up. And so what we're I'm seeing a lot of are people that want jawline contouring, for example, because there's the millennial that's doing the selfie and they realize that Gigi Hadid has this very slim face with a sculpted cheekbones. And they're like, I want that. Or it's also like, you know, the housewife that's, you know, mid 40s that's like, hey, I don't want a facelift, but I don't like having this whenever I've got the camera from below. What can we do about it? And so that's non-surgical things. And those fall in line with things, with skin tightening devices, like FaceTite's kind of the biggest one we do right now, which is like a radio frequency heat that is an internal probe. And what that does is kind of it tightens skin head to toe. So you can use that for jawline, specifically faces. You can do arms, legs, whatever, you know?
Whoa,
and so
that's
kind of what we're seeing a lot, like especially out of the Zoom boom, if you will.
Yeah. What would you see the breakdown of male to female clients that you guys have?
You know, so when it was really crazy when I first opened, you know, if you'd asked me when we first opened the doors there, it was actually a higher percentage of males than I would have guessed. The male population has increased, but not at the same rate the female population has in my practice. So right now it's probably maybe 10% male, but when I first opened, it was probably 33% male. So it's, you know, it's not just, you know, it's not just for ladies anymore there, Hans, you know, I mean, and so
I'm asking for a friend.
It's cool. No, it's, this isn't a consultation. This is a privacy thing. We've never met before this. But, and you know, the follow-up question you're gonna say is, well, hey, what are guys doing?
Yes.
And that's a great question. I'm glad you thought of it.
Thank you.
So obviously Botox, which sounds very similar to Botox, but the difference is it's more masculine and less intimidating. We also will typically, for the Botox, the music in the room will change from whatever the lady picks to whatever the gentleman picks, which is typically a little bit more, you know, masculine, upbeat. I'm kidding, but it's not. when you're in my chair, you pick the tunes, right?
Right.
So if Lindsay's there, she can pick whatever she wants. If Hans is there, he picks whatever he wants. I do have some special veto power because some music's a bit weird to be injecting to.
Oh, sure. Good.
Yeah, like the Keith Sweat. Someone was playing Keith Sweat one time and I was trying to do Botox. And I'm like, dude, I can't, this is just a little too much. It's a little too romantic. There's that. Some guys do fillers, not as common as women, but you know, fillers for like cheekbones, you know, or the nasolabial lines on gentlemen. The face tight thing is really kind of a common thing for guys because, you know, as a male, you know, you don't want to go under the knife because it's very, you know, I don't want to do surgery. That's weird, but it's perfectly okay to do non-surgical things, right? So guys will, like, I know a lot of guys that will do like skin tightening, cool sculpting, things like that. But the thought of liposuction or facelift, they're like, no way I'll ever do that. So guys, it's more of the non-surgical realm. Now, that being said, there are guys that I do like ab etching on. So liposuction with kind of creating the six pack muscles, or some gentlemen will have kind of the gynecomastia, which is kind of the male breast fullness. And we'll take care of that with liposuction as But yeah, I've had a couple male facelifts, a few rhinoplasties in guys, but not as commonly. But you got to imagine, like, what do you see right now on me besides awesomeness in my suit? And it's, you know, typically stuff above the collarbone, right? It's like, as opposed to like Lindsay over here, you can actually see more of Lindsay. And so for me to do anything, hey, this show's PG-13 for kids. So, so that's what guys do. Women, obviously there's more of a kind of width. You know, women do things from head to toe. Men, it's typically kind of collarbone up. Occasionally they'll do the six pack thing. But that's about it.
Interesting. So I have to know, on the Botox, are girls tougher than guys when it comes
100%. To like, not even 100%.
I don't doubt that.
You know, it's, I mean, I'm a guy, so I can say this, right? But when we have a guy that comes in for anything, we always know that, you know, there's going to need to be an extra hand in the room to kind of help out with.
Yeah.
Like, you're okay.
Yeah, it's okay. That's going to be fine. I mean, we do that for the ladies too. But gentlemen need a little bit more. I always make the comment. It's like, if you told a woman, like, hey, if you stand on one foot and hop up and down and hold these electric cables, you'll be 5 pounds lighter and 5 months younger, a woman would do it.
Like,
a guy,
cables.
You would tell them, hey, if you take this pill, you'll look young forever. A guy's going to be like, yeah, I don't need that pill. I'm good.
That's
fine. So it's, you know, it's all. But it's also different too, because even in the consultation, for example, like, it's funny because it's kind of like shopping for a suit, right? If a guy goes to buy a suit, he's coming home with a suit. If you go shopping for shoes or a handbag, you may not come home with one, right?
Or both.
Whatever. But you may not do it. But if you go to Target, you'll come home with everything, I know.
Yes, definitely.
But guys, like, so that's the difference. When one comes in for a consult, typically the male books almost 100% of the time. Whereas women kind of like to shop around a little bit and do their thing.
Definitely.
Now, there also is the funny thing of like aftercare, because obviously it's not, I do awesome stuff, but there's also the fraction, there's a part of it that's like, you know, you guys have to do the right thing afterwards, right?
Right.
I'm not you guys, but you guys. And so males are usually not the best at following instructions after an operation, as opposed to women. Like literally, like I will send post-op instructions to patients and it's almost like a pop quiz the next day with the women, because I'm like, so you said on page 9, column 3 that I could do this, but did you really mean that? And I'm like, wow, I never caught that typo. Like, I appreciate that. But yeah, so yeah. They will follow it to the T. It's crazy.
Yeah.
So, you know.
That's so crazy. So, okay. On that note, what do you feel like makes you specifically different as a doctor, like compared to, because if these women are shopping and they're going to a couple of different doctors, like...
Well, that's good. I mean, that's a great question, because you know how it is. It's the same thing in real estate. It's the same thing in whatever Chick-fil-A over there, whatever business you're in.
Right.
You have to... what sets you apart? It's your brand. Why is Starbucks coffee the best best coffee? It may not be the best quality, but it's Starbucks, right?
Right.
Apple computers. And so you're doing the same thing when you start any business. And so, you know, in selling plastic surgery, I'm selling myself and kind of our team, right? And so what... I always tell, you know, it's funny you mentioned this, because we actually literally like 2 weeks ago, we had our 2020 goals meeting with the entire team. We sat down for drinks and we kind of went, 2021, I'm sorry.
Okay,
thanks,
Mike.
It's good.
I don't even know.
Feels like we're still in 2020.
What year is
sometimes.
This? 2021. Thank you. So we had our 2021 goals meeting. And one of the things we talked about was our brand and why is our brand different? And so, you know, the brand that we are, that I advocate and I say is, you know, we're like Neiman Marcus, right? Mm-hmm. You know, you can go to, you know, I don't want to sell any company store short, but you go to Walmart, you go to Target, you can get some shoes, right? But if you want the experience of being pampered and knowing that you're getting high quality, you'll go to Neiman's, you'll go to Nordy's, you'll do one of those things. And so the same with us, right? You know, you can throw a rock out here and probably hit someone injecting Botox, but you're coming to me for the experience of Botox. Mm-hmm. You know that my hand has been trained for a decade of postgraduate training. Right. You know that I've injected tons of Botox. You know that, that heaven forbid something bad happens, I can fix it.
Right.
As opposed to, you know, Hans with a needle out back. Yep. If he bugger something up, you don't know how to fix it, right? And so that's, you know, so we're the concierge Neiman's experience. If you call us at midnight, someone's gonna answer and take care of you. You know, you're not a number. You come into the practice as an individual. And so a plan that may work for Lindsay may not work for the lady over there. It's the same thing, right? So it's individualized to her. And then what makes, you know, me unique? Well, I mean, obviously the awesomeness is palpable, but.
Can we show that awesome photo?
Yeah, there you go. I mean, that awesomeness is palpable, right? I mean, not every plastic surgeon gets Bernie Sanders in their office.
See, that's
right?
A big deal.
I mean, I'm a celebrity plastic surgeon, Bernie Sanders. And then also, I mean, we do silly things like that too. And so I think part of my personal brand is, you know, levity. I think that, you know, there's two things that patients always seem to tell us about me specifically. And I hate bragging myself. I'm from the Midwest. You don't brag on yourself from the Midwest, right? I don't even like getting compliments. It makes me uncomfortable, right? So like if you're like already hugging, like the coronavirus thing's been kind of awesome because I have to hug right now. I have an excuse to never hug.
Yeah.
But no, I mean like, and so the things that patients always say, what sets me apart specifically is, you know, silliness like that. And then also like, you know, it's the comprehensive evaluation and consult you'll have with us. Mm-hmm. If you come in here to my office for a consult, I don't want to say bring a notepad, but you're going to get so much information that you will like leave there like blown away, because I will tell you everything that can go wrong and how we're going to try and avoid it. And if it does go wrong, what we're going to do about it. And so it's an educational experience. And that's my goal, is because I basically, you know, when it comes to cosmetic surgery or plastic surgery, I don't like the term cosmetic surgery. We can go into that next video we do together. But, it's a partnership, right? If my knife touches your skin, then you and I are, it's a very intimate thing. And we're married until either you fire me or one of us keels over, right? Mm-hmm. And so you have to have that trust there. And so I have to trust with you, knowing that if something bad happens, we're in this together, and you have to feel the same way about me, right? You know, it's like a, you know, ship, right? Captain of the ship. You have to trust the captain of the ship at all times. Right. Otherwise you're in trouble, right? And so that's kind of, I don't know what question I'm answering right now, but in essence, that's kind of the feeling I want you all to have.
Why people choose you,
And also liking, I feel like.
Sometimes the words just come out and I don't know where it's really going. And going. I black out and then I wake up and next thing I know, I'm at work.
No, you're good.
I don't know if I love that in a plastic surgeon, but work is amazing.
Well,
so
I appreciate that. Thank you. But yeah, so I appreciate that too. That's the other aspect of why people choose us. But I mean, in reality, it's like, you know, it's the same thing with real estate. It's the same thing in your business, right? There, you know, you can get a good result with a million people in there. You can also get, you know, the same service from other people? You get the same house from other realtors, but what are they? Right. Yeah. What do you specifically bring that makes you awesome realtors? Is a completely different thing, and that's why you choose me, because of the fact that you're not going to get just some. I mean, like I said, there are some patients that say I was going to so and so for years, and you've said more in 5 minutes than I've ever heard any doctor ever say to me. And I was like, well, I talk a lot, but also there's a lot of stuff coming out. So yeah. Anyway.
Yeah, I would suggest you guys go check out his Instagram, yes. Lone Star Plastic Surgery, because it shows he's got a lot of different procedures posted on there. Yep. There's a couple of photos of Dr. Sean Hill doing his thing. But it's really, really cool. Just digging through your Instagram, I'm like, oh, wow, you do a lot of cool stuff.
A lot of cool stuff. And it's also very entertaining. He's got, obviously, you can tell he's got this great, hilarious personality.
It's okay. But
it's no harm.
There's a romance here. It's real.
Is it uncomfortable being between the two of us?
You know, it's a little tight.
There's a reason they separated us.
It's a little tight, yeah. No, they can't sit next to each other. Yeah, for sure.
We wouldn't even be talking to Lindsay. We'd be like, hey, how's it going, man?
He's not a hugger unless it's me.
Yeah.
It's fine.
It's a bro hug.
Yeah,
right. Okay. Those are okay hugs.
A brug.
No.
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 I have one question.
You handle the handsomeness, I'll handle the funny.
Yes. Okay. Yes, sir. That's my bad. My bad. Okay. No, I have a legit question that I've always wanted to ask a surgeon is, do you do anything special to take care of your hands? Because that's your career. Is there special precautions or anything like that?
Well, I don't shake hands. No, I'm kidding. No. So, obviously every field has disability insurance, and you always hear these stories oh, J-Lo has her booty insured from $1 million, right? So, I mean, yes, I do have a disability policy on my hands. So if I could not be a surgeon tomorrow, then I would be collecting money for that, right? So that's kind of the same thing, specifically to my hands is I don't get manicures as much as Melanie wants me to go get manicures. I get to get one. But I mean, for example, that's a good point, because I mean, one thing that I have is something called Raynaud's phenomenon, which you may not be familiar with. But in essence, if I'm in the cold, my hands will my fingers from here on out will turn bright white, and I will have pain and tingling in my hands. And so it could get severe enough for some people that they actually get open wounds on their hands. Right.
Oh, wow.
And so I'm from Illinois originally. Why didn't you go back to Illinois, Sean? Well, number one, DFW is way more awesome for plastic surgery practice. But number two, it's cold up there. My hands would hurt in the winter. I hated it. Yeah. Here I am in Texas, sunny Texas with my hands.
Yeah. Nice
in the winter.
Hands.
They're nice and
they're just lovely. Yeah.
Thank you. Right. I got to cut on it. Don't show that. Can you airbrush that out?
Yeah.
Right
yeah.
there.
Holden,
can you airbrush that out for me? Buddy? Yeah.
There we go. Thanks. We got this. So you mentioned Melanie. That is your beautiful bride.
Yes.
Congratulations,
yes. Well,
by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And you also mentioned that you guys are currently in the process of building a house in Frisco.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So bringing it back to real estate. Look at me.
Master of the segue.
Kind of walk us through that process, because we do deal with a lot of people that are thinking about building now that everything is kind of changed as far as what that home dynamic looks like. So how's that been for you guys?
You mean how I met Melanie or how I...
No, the building process.
Start from the beginning.
It worked out well. I mean, obviously you guys are in real estate, so I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but your listener or viewers, I guess, technically out there.
Sure.
We were originally looking for a old house, which I use air quotes, because in Illinois, an old house is one from the 19-teens.
Right.
And here in Texas,
Frisco.
A new house is 1990 something. I'm like, oh, it's an old house. But we were looking for one of those, and we realized we would put bids on a few houses, and every house we put a bid on, basically would be, $10,000-$20,000 over mark, over book price or whatever, and it'd be gone in a weekend. And so we're we're losing out on all these things. And then we kind of looked in the area there, and obviously there's so many new houses being built in Frisco. And so, Melanie is in real estate, so she pinpointed our specific neighbor, which is Hollyhock, which is in North Frisco next to where the PGA headquarters is going to be built. And so she's just like, hey, this is a neighborhood that I've been trying to get all my clients into. This is one we should be in.
Yep.
And so we kind of found a price point that was in our thing and
built
the house. And, building a house is obviously time consuming. I mean, you probably could have found the photo of me building the house on there, but actually, I've been busy building this house by my own two hands. building houses is time consuming too, right? Because you have to go do the custom home things. You have to go meet with these people and pick all these things out. And God knows I'm a male and I'm colorblind. So for me to pick things out, it's I don't really, it's all you. So every company has their own thing. And so the one that we chose was kind of more of a Sean friendly one, because I'm not picking out light fixtures and where every little thing goes. It's pretty much
package.
Exactly. It's packages, right? Yeah. So it's hey, you have one of five things, you pick it and you're done. And I'm oh, cool. That's awesome. you know, the downside to that is obviously if we want a light fixture somewhere, we have to pay extra, right? Right. Sure. Or we have to put it in ourselves right. after the fact. And so there are negatives, but the positive was I didn't have to go sit at design meeting after design meeting. Yep. And there's no amount of bourbon in the world that could have made that terrible. And so I'm glad that we did what we did, because it's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's very exciting.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pull it back to plastic surgery.
No, I appreciate that.
Yeah.
He's like, that's the only question I have.
That was our obligatory real estate talk.
Oh, yeah. Okay, cool.
Now we can talk about something interesting. Got it in there. So it's fine.
I want to ask you what advice you would give to people who are thinking about having plastic surgery.
You know, that's good. I mean, that's a good question. And I'll even take it back to kind of what I said a second ago and repeat myself, which is what I do best. You know, like I said, plastic surgery is, you know, you can fly to like Guadalajara and get plastic surgery. You can go anywhere and get plastic surgery, but you need, in my opinion, you know, like I said, it's an intimate marriage, right?
Right.
When my knife touches your skin, we're married, no matter how much you love me or hate me. So you need to find a surgeon that you don't want, that you actually will be willing, because, you know, heaven forbid something bad happens, you and I are going to see each other a lot.
Yes.
And if that's a person you don't want to be around, it's kind of like getting married, right? Uh-huh. You go on a bunch of dates. And if you marry everyone you go on a date with, you're going to hate yourself because you're like, oh my God, I can't believe this person does this or that.
Yeah.
And so, you know, when you come to my office, like it's, you know, the first part of the consult is you and me sitting in my office, my actual office, mm-hmm. across the chair from one another, or across the table from one another, just chatting. Because and in reality, you know, I hate to ruin this for all my patients, but it's basically they think they're trying to get to know me, but it's actually it's both.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I need to realize, hey, is this a person that is an appropriate operative candidate? And is this a person that I actually want to operate on as well? And so we have to basically kind of mesh, like, well, I need to understand what the patient wants me to deliver. And I need to make sure that I'm the person that can deliver these results. And so it's, you know, I think number one, you need to have a personality match. That's a given. But then number two, you know, it's kind of like, I don't want to like pat myself on the back there, but one of the things you said earlier on there is like, find someone whose credentials are legit, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, that person in Guadalajara doing plastic surgery could be, you know, trained at Harvard, and they could be just the fact they're a Mexican citizen, they couldn't practice in the States.
Sure.
But they also could be someone who did like a weekend fellowship and watched some YouTube videos on breast augmentation and suddenly they're doing it, right? I mean, you think I'm making a joke, but I mean, there are practices within a stone's throw of here where people are no more well-trained than that doing cosmetic surgery in patients. Yeah, I know, right? I don't want to name names, but it's inappropriate. So what you need to do is not only find a personality match, but go on their website or their social media or whatever and check their credentials. Do your due diligence. Because when you're a board certified plastic surgeon, Lindsay's going to say, what's that mean? She even asked me that a second ago. She's like, what's double board certified mean? Well, let me tell you something, Lindsay. Number one, you need to make sure the board actually is legit, because some people will put they're a board certified whatever, and their board may be something that is as irrelevant as me being a board certified tree hugger, right? Yeah. I mean, like there is no board that certifies tree hugging.
Right.
But and same thing for, I don't want to rag on cosmetic surgery. That's why I said earlier, I don't want to be known as a cosmetic surgeon, because a plastic surgeon is not a cosmetic surgeon. What's the difference?
Mm-hmm.
Good question, Lindsay. she's so good. But there actually is a board of plastic surgery that is one of 24 medical boards that actually basically to be board certified, you have to show not only that you have excellence, fund of knowledge, but your patient care is excellent. You have good ethics. I have to submit all of my marketing, all my websites to get board certified.
Oh,
okay.
Nice.
Oh, wow.
And so, and then I also every year for the rest of my life have to submit a certain number of continuing medical education hours, right?
Yeah.
That is part of the American Board of Medical Specialties, of which plastic surgery is one. Cosmetic surgery does not have this. It's pretty much like Hans could almost be a cosmetic surgeon, mm-hmm. because really all you need to do is do a fellowship in cosmetic surgery after doing 1 year of medical training, right? So those cosmetic surgeons could be anything from emergency medicine doctors, mm-hmm. OB-GYN doctors, family doctors, what have you, with no surgical experience except for that.
Wow.
And so you need to look for a board certified plastic surgeon. They don't necessarily have to be double or triple board certified or all those things, but board certified by the American Board of Plastic Surgery is, you know, there's a stamp on everyone's website who is that.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something that we take pride in and we police our own. I mean, if someone is in violation of these things, they will be, you know, the board will come down upon thee.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm rambling. So.
No, have you ever had to turn a client away?
Oh yeah. I mean, it's
really,
it's hard. Cause I mean, like, you know, it's like, you know, because when it comes to like the logistic or the realism of being a in my field is like being in your field, right? You need to make a living, right? And so you're like, say to yourself, oh, you know, I can deal with this client or whatever. And I guarantee if you ask every plastic surgeon, they will tell you the horror story of like, oh, I can't believe I said yes to this and now we're doing this. And it's just, you go down this thing. And so that's why I say is, you know, whenever I sit down with that patient, I need to make sure, number one, that they are an appropriate operative candidate for safety reasons. But then number two, that they've got appropriate or realistic goals. Because if someone, if I walked in and said, I look like Hans after this operation, then the doctor's gonna be like, yeah, that's not possible, right?
But if you said Justin Timberlake.
So I mean, like if a person walks in with a photo of themselves when they're 17 years old and they're in their 60s, you're just like, look, that's helpful. But I mean, this is not, you know, this is not realistic. And so those are the things you gotta make sure. So yes, I have turned people away that may not have realistic goals it's not usually personality things. I mean, quite frankly, I can get along with pretty much anyone.
Yeah.
It's more so the patient's getting along with me, I think, just in the respect that, you know, they have more choice. They have choices. And so you don't just pick, you know, everyone that takes you to prom. You don't marry all your prom dates.
Right.
It's a good idea.
Unless you're Hans.
Yeah. Awkward. No, you're good. So when people find out that we're realtors, they always ask us, how's the market? So when people find out that you're a plastic surgeon, which just sounds so cool, what is the question that you get?
Number one is, well, what do you think I need done? That's not just like in like at the bar. That's like literally I'll be in my office. Well, like they'll come in for a consult and they'll be like, what do you think I need to have done? And I'm like, number one, I never answer that question.
Oh, seriously?
It's like Hans can relate to this, right? It's like when Lindsay comes out and she says, how do I look in this? Or do I look fat in this? Right. You never say you look fat. And then you're like, oh no, honey, you look great.
Mm-hmm.
She never does, right?
Okay, right.
But there's always a nice way to say like, well, maybe you should wear something or I really like you in that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I never say it, number one. That's like you're going to get yourself in trouble.
Oh my gosh.
Because I may think that someone has like the worst nose known to man, but that might be grandpa's nose to them. And they may be like, oh God, no, that's grandpa's nose. I love my nose. And I'm like, oh God. Yeah. You know, like there's always like the story of like the plastic surgeon who comes in the room to see a patient and says, oh, you're here to get your nose done. And it's like, no, I'm here for tummy tuck. Like, you know, number one, that's the common question. And then it's funny, I just hired a new receptionist and she sent a text to the group last weekend. She's been with us for like 2 months now.
Yeah.
And she's like, how many people want to show you their breasts once they realize you work for a plastic surgeon? And Melanie's even made the comment before to me, and she's just like, how many emails of photos of boobs do you have on your phone? And I'm like, a lot. I mean,
like, no, it's so awkward for Melanie. I'm like,
I think at first she found it like, she's like, that's really weird that all these women want to show you their breasts, and then she realizes, yeah, whatever, it happens. Yeah. It's
literally your job.
Yeah,
so, yeah, I mean, it's not, because I mean, like, you know, you might judge a house when you first look at it, but you're not thinking, you're thinking of it as your realtor eyes on it, not your, a poor man's house. I don't think like, oh my God, what's wrong with you? I just think, okay, there's a breast. What do I need to do to fix this up? Okay, you know, and so it becomes like your job,
like an
right?
Art.
Yeah, it's like the Terminator, right? Like I see it, and then I make it happen, right? And so that's what it is. It's not the judgmental thing. So
yeah,
right.
So yeah, what do I need done? It's always funny too, because like you guys do probably a fair amount of networking, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the old networking nights, it's usually like early in the evening before the drinks are flowing, everyone's just kind of feeling each other out. And then by the end of the night, every once in a while, someone will always kind of sidle up to me and they're like, so, Dr. Hill, I got a question for you. So those are always the best ones.
Yeah,
it's never who you think it's going to be at those networking.
Really?
It's always funny when it's like the burly man come up to me and say, so Dr. Hill, what do you think I can do about my eyelids?
Eyelids.
I wouldn't have guessed that, but there you go.
Yeah, that's entertaining.
That's hilarious. Yeah.
So I kind of want to do like a challenge.
Okay.
We keep talking about Botox.
Are we arm wrestling?
You guys need to arm wrestle first, obviously.
Oh God, that's a gun show. That's why I'm wearing long sleeves. He's wearing short sleeves.
You don't want to show off your guns.
I don't want to. If I flex, the suit rips.
Yeah. Yes, I can
appreciate
that. Why don't we do Botox on Hans, guys? Should we? How about if we get enough comments on this video, we will have Dr. Sean come back.
Is that where it goes?
I mean, you know, yeah. In your professional evaluation, it would be.
What would you do to me, Dr. Sean? What would you do to me?
Well, let me tell you first, Hans, I would, I don't do that, man. No, I mean, most common places for Botox, forehead, 11s, right? Those are the two most common things. And then the third most common spot are typically the crow's feet, right?
Okay.
Most people don't start with all three of those. Most people start with forehead and maybe the 11s.
Yeah.
And so if you were to start, that's typically where.
Sure.
Yeah, okay, I'm sorry. Yeah. Angry face, Lindsay, show him.
You do your angry face.
There you go.
And then you do your surprise face. Angry. Surprise. So I'm a professional as well.
Lindsay Jones
work in my office. If this realty thing doesn't work out for you, I'm pretty sure I have a job for you.
Okay. There we go. That's my resume.
Yeah. Nice.
Okay. If we get enough comments about Bro Talks on this, we will have Dr. Sean come back on and do Bro Talks live.
Comment below, right?
You will come here and do live Bro Talks.
Yes.
On this face.
So hopefully you guys found something amazing today. I had a good time, so hopefully y'all had a good time.
Thanks for coming. Of course.
I brave the traffic south here. I'm so far south of my home base right now.
Right? Yeah.
Baby steps. Welcome to Dallas.
This is what it looks like down here.
But yeah, if you saw something helpful, please like, share, subscribe. Again, any questions that you have for us, hi@3vinegroup.com. But Dr. Sean Hill, where can we get a hold of you?
There you go. Hey, look, there's a website there on the screen. If you can't see it, it's LoneStarPlasticSurgery.com. You can, you know, check out our gallery. You can follow our social media. Quite frankly, the website's great, but if you really want to get to, like, up to the minute, like, stuff of what we're doing, in fact, there'll probably be a video of this on there now, is our Instagram, which is @LoneStarPlasticSurgery.
Yes.
Facebook's the same title. We are starting TikTok. Don't ask me about why I got suspended recently from TikTok.
Actually, you should. You should.
That's the next time. But TikTok also will be @LoneStar_PlasticSurgery. Follow us on one of those forms of social media. But otherwise, the website's good too.
There you go.
Perfect. Awesome. Well, thank you so much.
All right, guys.
Thanks, sir.
And we'll see you next time on More Than Home.
More Than Home.